get to N by itself. It's not about what we have to do or what we should do, but what's something that we could do.
Just add 10 to each shot.
Add 10. That would be nice, right? It looks like N is closer to being isolated. When we add 10 to negative 10, we get 0. So do the same thing to both sides, because remember, if we were to add 10 to one side, and let's see, if we were to add 10 to one side and not the other, then what did we do?
It made it off balance.
It made it off balance. And that's, remember that an equation is a perfectly balanced set of scales. One side is exactly the same as the other. They're equal. And if we do one thing to one side, we do the same to the other. So we don't throw it out of balance. 4n equals 22. And then to get n by itself.
Divide both sides by 4.
Divide both sides by 4. Because 4 divided by 4. This goes back to simplifying rational expressions. Right? 4n divided by 4 can be simplified to n. Because 4 divides 4. Because 4 is a common factor here. And divide 22 by 4. You get 5.5. Or 22 over 4. Or 11 over 2. Are fine.
So if you left it 22 over 4, is that wrong?
No, it's not wrong. It is equal to the correct answer. Now, if I say something like simplify or report as a decimal, or if I ask for a specific kind of response, then it could be wrong if you haven't taken some step that I want you to do. But no, 22 over 4 is correct. So don't be mad at your grader. No other questions? We're ready for the review? Okay, then let's pass in our homework and our pink slips. And make sure our desks are ready for the schedule review. I hope you like that. Okay, so we'll start off nice and easy. We have some number minus 9 is 13. So we know 13 is 9 less than what we want. So we're going to want a number that is 9 more. 19 or 13, right? So add 9 to both sides. 22. We want to know what k is. We're told what 5 times k is. 5 times some number that we want to know is 40. So clearly this guy is 5 times as we need. So 5 by 5, or we want to just cancel out this multiplication by 5. That way. 8. Okay. So here I wanted to talk about a common mistake that happens. So why is Rick wrong to multiply by 3/8 this step here? Yeah?
You have to multiply by the reciprocal, so everything cancels out.
So everything cancels out. So what is Rick doing? Like what does Rick wind up with here? 9/64 m. That's, we can deal with that, right? But it doesn't do what he thinks it does, right? He thinks that it cancels it out, but it doesn't. 3 times 3 is 9, and 8 times 8 is 64. But if instead of doing that, get rid of that, that's not going to be right. Multiply by 8 over 3, we get 24 over 24 if we want to go through that extra step. And 24 divided by 24 is 1. Here we would multiply by 8 thirds. Cancel the 3 with 15. We get 5. 5 times 8 is 40. So m is 40. So if that's you, if you make that mistake, then learn from Rick. Don't make that mistake. Because if you make the mistake, you'll never know what m is, and your life will be so sad. Any questions? Remarks? Sarcastic comments? Nope, too late for sarcastic comments. So go ahead and pass them back to the owners, and then we will pass them in once you're done having a look. What? So take a look at this equation.
Yes?
Is today the 30th?
Yes, it is. You gotta figure out, since we were so good at the equations we just solved, we had no questions and we felt confident, we're gonna move on to having variables on both sides. So maybe this is simple, maybe it's not to you. Here, let me propose something. I'll subtract 7 from both sides. Do 3x equals 5x minus 20. Alright, and just like I've always done, to get x by itself, I'll divide by 3. So x equals 5x minus 20 divided by 3. I don't even need to clean it up, I'll just leave it like that. What's the problem with that? It does say x equals, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, but there's an x on both sides still.
Okay, so what's wrong with that?
We have to get x on the one side.
Why?
Because x, because we don't know what x is, so we can't say that x equals itself. Times anything.
Well, I can assure you this is true.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
True.
Well, it's like saying that a bus is a bus. It's true, but it doesn't really help you figure out what a bus is.
Okay. Yeah, it's kind of great.
You
know. Oh,
hey.
Come on.
Your
glasses
are
making a little hard to see.
Yeah, I can drop my things already.
Exactly, it's like saying bus is a bus. I have to know what a bus is before I can know what a bus is, right? I'm trying to figure out what x is, so to tell me what x is in terms of x doesn't help, right? In order to figure out what x is, I would have to know what x is to start with. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's not all that helpful. Not all that helpful. All right. So is it true? Do we have to get x all by itself on one side, of course. That is true. That is correct. So how do we do it?
After you subtracted 7 from both sides, you get 3x.
Oh, I could have done that. Okay. All right.
Then you just subtract 5x. So now x from both sides, so now x is isolated. So you can divide by negative 2 and then do the next
3. There you go. Very good. And now x is a number, and we know the identity of x, and that's the whole point. To say x is equal to something with x in it doesn't get us anywhere. Okay. So, let's see if I can this one at you guys. Take care of this one.
Let's see if that message got through to you.
All right, we'd like to get the variable on one side by itself. I'd like to do this first. I'm going to decide which side to subtract p's from. Which, like, what would you suggest, Jethro?
To me, it really doesn't matter, just as long as I can isolate it.
Okay. No, it doesn't matter. Like, the truth of what p is will still be there. But there's something that just makes it slightly easier on myself.
Subtract the 7 from the 9.
Yeah, I like it to be positive, so I'll just subtract the smaller, and I'll just do whenever I'm done, I make sure that the p's are positive. It doesn't really matter. Jethro is right. But it does help if it's positive. Okay. We'll add 5, add 5, and we'll get 18 equals 2p. Divide by 2. Okay, if I had done this slightly differently in my p's were negative, I always have to divide by a negative at the end instead of a positive. I have negative 2p equals negative 18. Still gonna get 9. But I like to not divide by negative. Just a simple little thing. I'm gonna throw another one up there, and then I'm gonna show you what you might do by accident. I might get a little carried away. I might try to do a bunch of stuff all at once, which is fine, but you gotta be careful, because here's what could happen. Minus 5x, 3, 2x equals negative 50. You ready to catch what's wrong with that?
x and the 3, there's nothing on the left side.
There's nothing over there. So I don't have 2x equals negative 15. I do get a 2x and I do get a negative 15, but they're on one side together. Right? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
They're over here.
Okay.
I can do all this, and let's just show that, though it's a little bit silly what we have, what we actually have. We have 0 on this side, and on this side we have 2x minus 15. Still true though. We've still done the same thing on both sides. Now we've corrected the error, and we have what is correct, 2x minus 15. Now we just need to solve for x, right? So, well, it's not like we've never done this before. We've got 15 to both sides. Divide by 2. X equals 15 over 2. Now, if I did want to do this all at once, and just kind of get the x's on one side, get the numbers on the other side all at one time, it would look similar, but if I want to subtract the 5x from both sides, I'll do that. And then I'll do what instead of subtract 3? Yeah, add 12 to this side. That way I know I'm going to wind up with some x's here, but I cancel out the numbers on this side. And over here when I add 12, I'll get some numbers here and no x's. Right? So I have x's on one side and numbers on the other. There we go. 15 equals 2x, and again, x equals 15. Just sharing with you an incredibly common mistake that I want you to avoid, if I can help you do that. So just watch out for that. Let's throw this one at you. X's on one side together. And that would include if there are X's, multiple instances of X's together on one side, we'll just collect like terms before we get started. So 12x is 2x plus 5, subtract 2x, add 3, 10x equals 5 plus 3 is 8, 10x equals 4 fifths. So really what I'm about to show you is going to be very similar to this problem. It's another hurdle to get over, which isn't really all that difficult. Kind of want it to look more like this, or a previous kind of an example. We want to be able to combine like terms, things kind of in our way. What do you think we should do about that, Jeff?
Distribute the 3 and then distribute the 5.
Okay, so we have 3x plus 6 equals 5x plus 20. We get to distribute it to that second thing that gets missed a lot. So you get distributed to everything. Remember, we can look at that, we can see that. This rectangle here, we get this area as 5x, this area is 5 times 4, 5x plus 20. All right, so now, well, it should be a piece of cake, because we have an equation that looks like those other equations. There's no parentheses to worry about. It's been dealt with, it's been handled, it's been respected in the order of operations. I'm going to subtract 3x, I'm just going to keep it positive. This side's still 6, we got a plus 20 here. Okay, minus 20, minus 20, negative 14. So x is negative 7.
Didn't show your work.
I didn't show my work? The dividing by 2 work?
Yeah, right, divide by 2.
I'm not a like show your work Nazi. I'm not going to mark you down because you didn't show divide by 2. Okay? But if I ask you, how did you get from here to there, because I'm not quite sure and you don't know, well then that's when we're gonna talk about it and figure it out, and I'm gonna explain to you what exactly we
we're doing here, okay? But
rest assured, I am dividing by two in my mind. I'm not saying two times some number is negative 14 and just guessing and checking. That's the thing I want you to avoid. So, questions about that? Unless I just give you a few that kind of sums up what we've done so far today. You feel ready for it? I'm even going to throw in a tricky one.
Okay.
If you're sharp, you'll be fine. The tricky one is going to involve distribution, but then when we collect all the like terms, everything will be hunky-dory. So, first one. This one.
First one.
Minus.
Oh, well.
Let me look at my paper. Plus four.
Good question.
Okay, this one I think we can run through pretty quickly. 3y minus 2y is y. We got a plus four. We'll go ahead and subtract y. This is 0, 4 minus 19 is negative 15, 6y minus y is 5y, and just to be sure, 19 minus 19 is 0, so I do have this right, 5y is negative 15. Divide by 5, just for Justin, and y equals negative 3. Just did one like this, right? This is one that's is recent. To distribute, we have 4x minus 12. Are there any questions on this one? Let me go through the two. Then over here, 4x minus 12 equals 10, no, equals 20x plus 40. So subtract 4x, negative 12 equals 16x plus 40. I'll subtract 40. Negative 52 equals 16x divided by 16. Negative 13 over 4, we can simplify that. Alright, so here's the one that's a little bit of a trick, and it seemed like we handled that pretty well. But just like with this one, we're going to go ahead and distribute so we don't have to worry about dealing with these parentheses in some other weird way. We'll just take care of them by distributing what's outside into the parentheses and work from it, you know, work from there. So we distribute the x to the x, what's x times x?
X squared.
Okay, you gotta remember x times x is x times x squared is x to the third, right? It's just how many x's are we multiplying together? In this case, x times x, two x's we're multiplying together. So x times 3, that's 3x, x times x is x squared, x times negative 5 is minus 5x. And, well, we're not distributing the 16, it's not in the parentheses, so that plus 16. Okay, so you might say to yourself, these x squares, if I have solved an equation that has an x squared in it, it's been quite a while. Right? What do I do about that x squared?
Subtract x squared from x squared.
Subtract x squared from both sides, and well, we'll put, you know, if I put minus x squared there, it wouldn't make any sense, right? Because they're not like terms. We'll combine like terms here. Well, x squared minus x squared is 0, so that's kind of nice. I get 0 x squareds on both sides. So I don't even have to worry about what to do about x squared. On this side, we're left with plus 3x and minus 5x plus 16. Add 5x to both sides. 8x equals 16. Divide by 8. Thank you. Everything good? Anything of concern? Questions?
On the first one, I should get 5y.
Okay, so first combine 3y plus 2y, or 3y minus 2y is 1y. Yeah? And I subtract y from both sides. Subtract y from both sides. So this here is 0y. 6y minus y is 5y. All right? Other questions? Okay.
I saw the plus and I thought it was that's. Mm-hmm. I thought it was like a four trick or something like that. So.
Okay, so just getting kind of confused about the, you know, maybe we write a little bit neater or something.
Yeah.
Take care of that. Abby?
Well, for the last one.
This one?
Yeah.
Yeah?
So I have 1x instead of x squared. Well,
yes.
I still got the same answer.
Well.
Is it just like not the.
It's a nice coincidence because I wrote it in such a way that the x squares would cancel. So if what you did was x times x is 1x, then this, what you had is 1x, and what you had is 1x here, would also cancel each other out. I did the exactly opposite. Okay.
Couldn't you also not distribute the x on the right side and then distribute the 16 instead?
Distribute the 16 into the parentheses?
Yeah, could you do that?
No. Because it's plus 16, we would do that if it was 16 times the parentheses,
okay.
Right? That's when we distribute.
Okay.
Anybody else have a question like that? Did you think maybe you could distribute the 16 instead? Just gotta think about it. It kind of comes down to the order of operations, and this x times the parentheses is what it would distribute. So, yes. Other questions? Great questions. Okay. Ready to break? Okay, let's break. X plus a equals 3. Okay, so, quote, solve for x. Get x by itself.
Subtract a.
Subtract what?
A.
Subtract a. X equals 3 minus a. Well, what is x worth?
3 minus a.
But we don't know what a is. And that's okay. So we've done all that we can do, given the information we're given. We don't know what A is worth. If we did, plug it in, we know what X is worth, right? If A were 2, then X would be 1, and whatever. So on and so on. Okay, so that's what we're going to be working on here, is getting X by itself, even though we don't wind up saying X is 10 or X is 15 or whatever. X is just on one side, and all the other variables are on the other side. Okay? So, let's see. This is actually a formula that you use, so you guys recognize it. You know what DRT stands for?
Distance.
Yes.
Distance.
Rate times time.
Yes, distance equals rate times time. You can remember it on that. So, well, this is solved for D, right? D is isolated. So let's get to T by itself. Let's figure out what T is worth. Justin, you want to just throw it out there? Tell us how to do it.
E equals rate, distance divided by rate.
Well, let's, you know, yes. But let's solve for T and, like, well, let's do this to both sides. What do we do to both sides? Divide both sides by t. What are we solving for?
T.
Divide both sides by t.
Yeah,
we're
solving for t.
Oh.
Think about when you solve for x, you divide by x.
R.
Divide by r. So if it was 3t, right? 3t, then we divide by 3. If it was 5t, we divide by 5. If it's r times t, we'll divide by r. It's a pretty useful thing to keep in your mind. If I want to solve for t or x or m or whatever, it's multiplied by something. Divide by that something, even if that something is a letter or some big monstrous expression. So yeah, D over R equals T. R divides R, and we're left with T on one side.
We should do E equals MC squared, or do rearrange that.
E equals MC squared.
We find the speed of light.
Well, the speed of light is a constant. It's not to be solved for. We can solve for M. How do we solve for M?
since m is being multiplied by c squared,
yes.
divide everything by c squared.
Yeah. Whatever c squared is, it will cancel itself out. It will divide itself to 1. Divide this by c squared, so e over c squared equals m. If we wanted to solve for c, solve for c. So how do we solve for c? If I take a couple of steps, divide by m, right? That cancels itself out. E divided by m. And just like dividing is the inverse of multiplying, and so dividing by m cancels out multiplying by m, the inverse of squaring is the square root. Right? If I wanted to figure out what c was, if c squared was something I want to figure out what c is, I take the square root, right? So take the square root of both sides, and the square root of e divided by m equals c. We'll back it up a little bit. That was one from the audience. It was interesting. Also, just back a little bit. Let's look at this guy. You know what this one, what this formula, this equation does? It's got input and output, yeah?
Converts Fahrenheit to Celsius.
Well,
vice versa.
It would convert Celsius to Fahrenheit, right? Because we would plug Celsius in there and do some stuff, and what would we have in the end? Something that's equal to F. So we take degrees in Celsius, plug it in there, multiply by 9/5, and add 32, and we get Fahrenheit. But what if we did want it to go from Fahrenheit to Celsius? We need to solve for C. We need C by itself, so that, I mean, really, we could put something in there for F and then solve for C over and over and over. We'll just make a new formula that it has C equals and then we're off. Justin?
So you multiply by 9/5.
Okay, now if I multiply, say I multiply this by 9/5.
No.
I'm gonna need to multiply this side by 9/5.
I meant 5/9, sorry.
Okay, 5/9. Let's change it to 5/9. Now whether I write this on this side of the parentheses or that side of the parentheses, what do I need to do with this 5/9?
Distribute
it. Okay, perfectly fine. We could do that. 5/9 f equals, well, the 5/9 times 9/5, what's that gonna be? C, 1. Yeah, 1 times c is what we're gonna have there. 5/9 times 32, well, that's 32 times 5/9. And then this will be C plus 160 over 9, or C plus 160/9 is
17.8.
What's that? Let's leave it as a fraction. We don't want to get these rounded decimals. But this is divisible by 3, and so is this. No, is it? No, it's not divisible by 3.
No.
That was our only hope. So it just stays 160/9 equals 5/9 f. All right, we're almost there. C is almost by itself.
Subtract. 160/9.
160/9. Yeah, good. One. So 5/9 f minus 160/9 equals c. Was anybody thinking differently? Like I would do this a different way. Okay, so I'm going to rewrite this. F equals 9/5 C plus 32. Jethro?
Subtract 32.
So now I get F minus 32 equals 9/5 C.
And then multiply by 5/9.
Okay, multiply, I'll just squeeze that in here. That's going to cancel. Well, keep in mind, if I multiply this by 5/9, I'm multiplying the right side. Remember, this is a balance. Scales. If I multiply one side by 5/9, boom, it changes it. You need to multiply this side by 5/9. Okay, so that it's equal, still equal to each other.
So what I'm trying, the point I'm trying to make there is, don't just multiply f by 5/9, or don't just multiply 32 by 5/9, multiply the whole thing, this whole left side, by 5/9. Distribute it. So 5/9 f minus 160/9. Like that, so that when I plug in f, I can just subtract 32, which is a fairly simple thing to do. And then once I have f minus 32, I can just multiply that number by 5/9. If you were to see, you know, look up Google Fahrenheit to Celsius formula or something, you'd probably see c equals 5/9 times parentheses f minus 32. Probably would see. The way they're equal, we have c by itself, and that's what we wanted. Equals c, you should look at. Everything that we would do with numbers, we do with letters too. Whatever the letters are doing, they represent numbers. So we would do the same thing. If we divide by a letter, or multiply by a letter, or subtract a letter, or whatever needs to happen, that's what we need to do. Trapezoid, which has two parallel lines. That's the only thing that it requires, really. It's just two parallel lines. It's a four-sided figure with one set of parallel lines. So this guy is a trapezoid. That's just a different kind of the same trapezoid. Okay, this is a trapezoid. Let's make this a little longer so you can see it's not a parallelogram. Okay, any trapezoid at all. Let's label the pieces. This is H. This is, let's call it B1, and this is B2. So that should show you that B1 and B2 are most likely not equal to each other. They're not the same thing. That's why we call them B1 and B2. They're kind of like X1 and Y1, X2 and Y2. We're just differentiating between two similar things. These are both what we could call bases. Okay. This is the first one, this is the second one. Or this is the first one, and this is the second one. It doesn't make any difference. Okay. So let's solve this for H. Let's get H by itself. It's kind of an easier one. Easier than maybe B1 or something like that. So how would we solve for H? We just cancel all the stuff that isn't H, so that H is by itself.
Do you need to distribute?
Distribute H?
Yeah. Or 1/2.
Well, really, 1/2 and h, if we're going to distribute, like, both would need to be distributed. Like, both things are being multiplied, right? Let's see. 1/2. So we'll just distribute both of them. It's written weird. I could write h right here instead of over here. It would be the same thing. So 1/2 b1h, let's call it that, plus 1/2 b2h. Does that look? Does that look like more isolated? Like H is more isolated or less isolated?
Less isolated.
Yeah. That's how I feel about it. I don't know how you feel about it, but H is now intermingling with this thing and this thing. Right? Does that make sense? So it's kind of harder to get it by itself. Right? And if you think about it, if I have an x here, and an x there, and an x there, like if we go back a few pages here, everybody had multiple x's or y's or whatever, we wanted to put them together and have like one term of h and not have multiple terms with the variable in it. So if we go back to the point we're on, see how we have h in a couple different places. So, I don't know, I think I'm gonna set that one to the side. If you think of something to do with that one, this one or this one? What do you guys think, Justin?
You could divide either 1 by 1/2.
Okay, divide by 1/2, multiply by 2.
Yeah.
Right, same.
Multiply by 2, multiply by 2.
2a equals b1 plus b2 in parentheses. That looks a little bit more isolated. Can you go somewhere from here?
No, I'm just starting over here.
Okay, start over. So we'll start over. We got a equals 1/2 b1 plus b2. What would you do?
Can't you just divide half times b1 plus b2 on both sides?
So not just divide by 1/2, but divide by the whole thing?
No. Leave H.
Well, the whole thing, this whole thing.
Yeah.
And the whole thing that isn't H. You can. And that can cancel that. And we're left with H equals A over 1/2 B1 plus B2. Of course. All solutions should be equivalent to each other, right? Otherwise, somebody did something wrong, or we have some like mystical dragon equation that is magic, which defies the laws of mathematics. How could we? I mean, this is done. H is by itself. Could we? I mean, take like one more step and be done with this one too.
Divide
by b1 plus b2. B1 plus B2. So 2A over B1 plus B2. H. Did all the work correctly. So that thing must be equal to this thing, although they look slightly different. Can we get this to look like that or vice versa?
Yeah.
As well?
You could multiply two of the
So multiply the numerator and denominator by 2 over 1. Well, in the denominator I get 1 times b1 plus b2. b1 plus b2 in the denominator. In the numerator I get 2 over 1 times a. Well, why am I saying 2 over 1? Why not just 2, right? 2 times a. There we go. It's the same. Exactly. Any questions about that at all? So a lot of this thing's multiplied by the thing I want to get by itself, so I'm going to divide. Worry about what A, B, and C B stand for. I just want you to solve for C. C by itself. Right, so we're going to solve for C. We're going to get C by itself. So, what are we doing to get C by itself? Around this, not because like any distribution needs to happen, because distribution only needs to happen when there's a plus or a minus in there, and there's not. Just grouping those together to show you, if I multiply 4/3 times pi times a times b, if I knew what a and b were, I would get some number, right? Say that number came out to be 17.359. That'd be 17.359 times c. So I just divide by 17.359. This is 17.359, so is this. Divide each other, cancel each other out. Of course, I need to do the same thing to both sides. 4/3 pi b. So b divided by 4/3 pi a b. There we go. but I do it differently. Like, I don't like a fraction inside a fraction. Can we clean it up, Ezra?
You could multiply by the reciprocal.
Okay, so start with taking 4 thirds pi a b c and multiply by 3 fourths. Multiply by 3 fourths. Okay. So then we'll get 3 fourths v equals pi a b c. And then what?
And then divide by pi a b.
So c equals 3 fourths v over pi a b.
Sure.
How about instead of that, if I take 4 thirds pi a b, divide that by pi a b, can I do that?
Yeah, that would be like
am I wrong or do we have like a lot of minutes left?
What time does it go?
So your day, it rings at 9:50, right?
Yeah. I feel like
we're
stuck.
Yeah.
Time to cancel.
Okay, pi AB divides pi AB. On this side, we get B over pi AB. Equals 4 thirds C, so I'll multiply by 3 fourths. This way I can see that like 3v over 4 pi ab is also equivalent. 3v over 4 pi ab. Any of those, they're all equivalent to each other. And it would be perfectly acceptable to me in an answer on a test. This one's the nicest. Because it doesn't have a fraction inside the fraction. Okay. And in any of these, we can make it so that it looks like this. So we multiply this by 3 over 4, multiply this by 3 over 4, as Azrael showed us on another problem similar to this. 3 fourths v pi ab. And I don't know how we will look at it, but this is like multiplying 3 fourths v pi over ab, it's like 3 fourths over 1. Like, I'll move this out here. Try and move this out here. It's like 3 fourths over 1. Well, anything over 1 is just itself, so that's 3 fourths times v over pi ab, and then 3v over 4 pi ab. Solve for y. Solve that equation for y. Okay. So, first, let's take this idea. Can we divide by 7x plus minus x?
No.
No.
Why do you say we can't divide by 7x minus x?
You can't. Is it because it's being subtracted? X is being subtracted? Or am I wrong?
Because X is being subtracted.
Negative X is being multiplied to 7.
Negative X is being multiplied by Y. Is that what you're saying?
Uh-huh.
Is 7X in any way involved being multiplied by Y?
No.
No, it's not. If we, and this is would be wrong to do, if there were parentheses around here, that's a different story. Now it's saying y times these parentheses are 7x minus x, right? So we would divide for that quantity like we've been getting used to doing. But that's not the case, right? So you don't be careful about that. How about, what would you do instead? Yeah?
I'd subtract 7x.
Good. See 7x as its own separate term, and you want to make it obsolete, you want to cancel it out, you want to get rid of it. You want to negate it, right? You get negative xy equals what? Negative 25x?
No, because it's just a negative 18, so it's negative 18 minus 7x.
Okay, so there's no combining these. They're not like terms. Easiest way to say it, shortest way to say it. They're not like terms, we just leave them alone. Okay? Mm-hmm. Anybody besides Jethro? Very excited, Jethro. Okay. Jethro? What do you say?
Then divide by negative x on both
by
sides.
Because that's the thing that's multiplied by y.
Y left alone.
Well, you have y left alone. Yeah. Y equals negative 18 minus 7x over negative x. Now, before you go canceling things out, remember this is exactly the kind of thing we had in the test not that long ago. If you want to write this differently, what you're trying to do is simplify this expression. Can you simplify this expression? If you can. If you want to say cancel out an x, remember, that means that we have to be able to write it as x over x times something, the simpler thing, the simplified thing. So that if we were to multiply these together, we would get negative 18 minus 7x over x. I want to cancel out negative x. How about that? So negative x times what gives me negative x? Very good. Negative x times what gives me negative 7x? Positive 7, excuse me. But how do I get negative x times something to give me negative 18? You don't. Or if you did, it wouldn't be much simpler. Yeah, it would be this fraction that's not any simpler. So careful before you just start writing new things and not thinking about what it means to do so. Ask yourself, this is a fraction, right? Dividing by negative x is a fraction. Can I simplify this fraction? If you can, you need to be able to write it just as I showed you a second ago. Okay. Now, let's get real fancy. Something like this. Equals. Now I'm going to solve for y. I won't make you work on this for very long by yourself because maybe you have an idea, maybe you don't. But I'd like to see what you come up with. If you're not sure what to do, that's fine. I'm just going to remind you about something. If I have, say, y equals 2300, whatever. Okay, but before I can have y by itself, I have it multiplied by anything. What do I do with that anything? If I wanted to
divide by,
because I want to get y by itself, right? I'm one step away from having y by itself at this point. Divide by stuff that's multiplied by y, right? A lot of times this is our last step of any solving is something is multiplied by the variable or the unknown. We divide by whatever that thing is. We can call it the coefficient, even though that coefficient might be weird looking. So maybe we can get this to look like that. To look like something times y, and then divide by that something. Anybody? Now that I just gave you that idea, is it possible to rewrite this so it's y times something? And then if we multiply that stuff together, we would get 9y plus 6y, or 6xy?
This? 9 plus 6x.
What's that?
9 plus 6x.
What do you think, everybody? Does it work?
Yeah.
How would we undo what Bridger just did?
Distribute y.
So what did Bridger do this way?
He got rid of the y and put the y together so you can and then you divide each side by that.
Yeah. Well, I'm just gonna give this a name, I guess, is what I'm saying. If this way is distributing, if I distribute the y to get this guy, what would you call it if I go this direction?
Undistributed.
That could be a thing that we call it. We could call it undistributing. It actually has a name, an actual name. It's not undistributed. But you could think of it as undistributed, and what it really is called is factoring out a y. Remember what a factor is. 3 is a factor of 15. How do I know that 3 is a factor of 15?
Because 3 times 5 is 15.
Exactly. Not 3 goes into 15, but 3 times 5 is 15. I've factored out a y. I've made y a factor by writing it as y times stuff. So now, as was said already, we can divide by that stuff and get y equals 30 over 9 plus 6x. You know what? I could write this as 3 over 3 times 10 over 3 plus 2x. Agreed? What we just really did is the same thing as with the y. We factored out of 3. Cancels that. There we go. Simplified that to 10 over 3 plus 2x. That is all I have.